supposed to be a skipping verb, where we study optomechanics or quantum optomechanics. And particularly, I work on microwave optomechanics, so we study radiation pressure effects in superconducting microwave circuits, which consist of capacitor, where top membrane can freely move, so it's suspended, and linear inductors. So canonical model for a cavity optomechanical system is a Fablipero cavity, where one mirror can actually move. And there are important effects. So normally, it's described by interaction Hamiltonian like this, which means that displacement of mirror modulates frequency of the optical mode or electromagnetic mode. And then you get shift depending on the motion, and you can derive radiation pressure force. So force with which radiation inside the cavity pushes on the mirror. And what's important is that when you try to measure position of the of this mirror, for example, in a LIGO interferometer or something like this, there is actually back action. So the light pressure changes position of the mirror when you measure position of the mirror. It happens because optical field in the cavity responds to the motion of the mechanical element with some delay, which depends on the cavity bandwidth, this kappa. So if you just write equation for the mechanical motion, for this mechanical oscillator, and you have all the terms and the radiation pressure on the other side, and then you do expand it, you will see that there is modification to the damping rate, to the mechanical damping rate, which is caused by light field. It depends on the detuning. If you have positive detuning of the laser from your resonance frequency, you will amplify mechanical motion. If the detuning is negative, you will damp it. So it's analog to laser cooling. So you can laser cool mechanical motion, or you can laser amplify it. It was all derived by Braginsky back in 1970, and also demonstrated even before that. And it was actually studied in connection to LIGO interferometer. Similar, very sensitive measurement systems. So if we switch to frequency picture and a little bit transform our interaction Hamiltonian, so what we do, we just linearize it around mean field in the cavity. So we assume we have coherent state of the light in the cavity with NC and cavity photons. And then we only look for fluctuations of the field. Delta A is now a fluctuation of the field in the cavity around this mean field. We can see that when our detuning is negative, so we pump around lower motional sideband, so detuned by mechanical frequency from the cavity resonance, we can get a kind of beam split Hamiltonian. So we take phonons and convert them to fluctuations of the field in the cavity, or vice versa. And of course, if your cavity is cold and has on resonance no photons, you take one phonon, put to the cavity, then take next photon, put to the cavity, next one, and one by one, you remove phonons from your mechanical mode. So you damp it, it becomes wider. Like here, so you start from this curve, you go to this curve. If you now put your laser on the upper motional sideband, so it's blue detuned to higher frequency by mechanical frequency, then your Hamiltonian can be linearized like this. So we only take terms which are energy conserving. That's why you only get these terms and not these terms in this case, because those will be rotating, and we apply rotating wave approximation. So on the blue side band, what happens, you amplify mechanical motion. It becomes narrow, because you create pairs of phonons and photons, and then phonons stay, and you build up coherently, like large amplitude coherent phonon state. And there are multiple cavity optomechanical systems with different masses and different principles, like the steroids, which we studied a lot, or photonic crystal cavities, which can be engineered quite well, or these microwave systems I will talk about. And there are many others. You can read this review. It's 70 pages review, which describes most of the quantum optomechanics by 2014. And on the theory side, you can basically derive everything in linear regime. So when you can apply this linearization by just writing down quantum Langevin equations. If you can write them and solve them with all the dissipation terms, you can basically describe everything. Okay, those small introduction fundamentals of quantum mechanics. And now I will speak about the following aspect. So connection between optomechanics and reservoir engineering. So our system is the following. We have mechanical oscillator, this yellow circle. We have microwave optical cavity, which is this circle, and we study phonons and fluctuations in the cavity, and it's detuned. And this cavity is connected to environment waveguide, and you have dissipation from the mechanical mode somewhere with rates, with a thermal decoherence rate, gamma m, and thermal. So effective rate depends on the number of phonons in the cavity. And in principle, it was demonstrated in trapped ions that if you have electromagnetic mode, which is a cold dissipative bus for your system of interest, you can prepare states of your systems. In case of mechanical motion, it was, you can cool it to the ground state or squeeze mechanical motion or in principle do something else. By just controlling this coupling G between mechanical mode and optical mode. And since we use linearized Hamiltonian, this coupling G in linear regime depends on the number of photons. It's some constant times square root of NC. So by just changing number of photons and changing the tuning of your pump, you can in principle prepare interesting states of mechanics. And it was first demonstrated for ions or suggested by Pajata, Strack, and Zoller back in 1996, and there was many experiments. And for the optomechanics, it was again suggested by Kronwald, Markert, and Clerk in 2013. And most of the experiments to date, they were done in this regime. And this regime can be characterized by two things. That to make it work, you need the decay rate from the electromagnetic mode, kappa, is much larger than decay rate from mechanical mode. Because what happens, when you increase this coupling, energy from this mode will decay through optical mode to the waveguide and not to the direct decay channel. And now the question is, but can we actually make mechanical resonator to be a bus or reservoir for light? Can we use the same system to construct interesting states of light? And yes, but we just need to make kappa much smaller than gamma m. Okay, let me go once again. So in standard regime, we have our interacting Hamiltonian linearized written like this, where coupling strength is G naught square root of NC. And when, for example, we cool, we just take phonons, put to the optical mode, and then they escape. And one by one, we can cool photons. If we do it faster than this rate, we can cool down to the ground state. Blue detuned, we create pairs of photons and phonons. Phonons stay, photons go to the waveguide much faster than we create phonons. And then we basically can amplify mechanical motion because phonons will keep the phase of the state in the resonator. It's all when its kappa is much larger than gamma m. But now if we go to different regime, kappa is much smaller than gamma m, then modification to the mechanical decay rate, I derived on the second slide, should become modification for electromagnetic decay rate. And in principle, the role should be just reversed. You should just now amplify microwave or optical mode, or damp optical mode. And so if we derive this modification, we can see it indeed from the series, you can calculate, you should get modification of the mechanical damping rate when you pump around lower or higher motional sideband. Around low sideband, you damp. Around higher blue sideband, you amplify. And there should be associated change in the frequency of the electromagnetic mode. So you should just pull electromagnetic mode somewhere by applying a pump. And overall, you can derive the response of the cavity measured in reflection with modification to the damping rate and modification to the frequency. And yes, you should amplify electromagnetic mode with mechanics. So mechanics will be gain medium for electromagnetic mode. So if we try to describe this amplifier, we can just write output field as a linear combination of all the input operators. And we will see that even resolved sideband regime, so if mechanical frequency is much larger than kappa, then it should be phase-preserving parametric amplifier according to description of Caves back in 1982. It should feature this gain, and on zero, on resonance, your gain should be 1 plus C or 1 minus C, where you see the cooperativity, it just shows the relative, or it's dimensionless coupling strength. It's coupling strength squared divided over decay rates of mechanical electromagnetic mode. And you see that if your cooperativity approaches unity, you should go to unstable regime because your gain is just diverges. And then if you calculate the noise added by this amplifier, you will see that it directly depends on the effective occupation of the mechanical oscillator. So if you want to create a quantum limited amplifier, which adds just one half of noise quanta, again, according to Caves, then an effective should be zero. So if you can create a cold mechanical reservoir for microwave mode, you should be able to realize a quantum limited microwave amplifier. Okay, I mean, if you have questions, you can probably ask now, because then I will switch to implementation.
Yes, so you linearize the Hamiltonian that is originally, the interaction Hamiltonian is originally proportional to n times x.
Yes.
Right? So what about keeping further terms and going non-Gauss? These effects are significant or not?
Up to now, they're insignificant. But if your coupling strength is high, of course, I mean, in some regimes, your contrasting term will become important. But this usually, you need large coupling strengths, or you pump with large number of photons. But then there are other nonlinear effects which kick in. Like everything heats up, you should get thermal shifts, and so on. So for most of the physics, up to now, it's insignificant, but there are cases when it can be significant, especially if you have extremely large coupling strengths for single photons.
And if the reservoir you think when you get gamma much larger than k, which means that the k minus 1, the minus 1 is much larger than gamma, the minus 1.
Yes.
So the time scale of the electromagnetic damping is much larger.
Slow. Well, basically, you don't get because of this, you don't get electromagnetic damping anymore. You get mechanical damping for electromagnetic mode because your time scale's changed.
Yep. There should be no Markovian effects there or not in the dynamics?
Till you can describe your mechanical mode as reasonably high Q, which means it's not Brownian motion, It should be still Markovian, I believe.
And entanglement does not play any role here?
No, there's no entanglement.
But between the mirror and the cavity movement of this?
Well, I mean, the only thing you can entangle is the fluctuations and the mirror position.
Right.
And for the mean field, and you can only measure mean field usually, so it's
it's
not relevant here. So now the question is, how can we realize this scenario? I mean, if we want just to make this gamma m small, well, we can just make low q mechanical mode, but then your thermal decoherence rate will be huge, because this will be large factor, and thermal is also large factor, because mechanical frequency it's quite low, it's in megahertz range, and then you won't get the cold reservoir. It will be a reservoir, but it will have a lot of phonons, and it will be useless. So what we suggested, that we can couple second mode with different decay rate, kappa 2, which is much larger than kappa, use the second mode to laser cool or sideband cool mechanical motion close to the ground state, and also damp it, and then use this combined mechanical mode or reservoir to operate the first narrow microwave mode. So it looks like this. We have white mode, we apply cooling tone, we cool mechanical motion, and then we apply, let's say, blue pump around main mode and see amplification, ideally. And in principle, our effective damping rate of mechanics can be described like this, where C2 is cooperative second mode, and staying in linear regime, you can make gamma effective almost kappa to half, so it should be much larger than kappa, and in principle, it's possible to realize. Well, this is how we fabricate our samples. So we deposit bottom electrode, we pattern it, we put sacrificial layer, we try to smooth the sacrificial layer, and then we do another lithography, we create sidewalls, then we deposit second electrode on top, etch it, and then do release, and we get our structure with even multiple electrodes on the fire substrate. And this process was inspired by a process developed at NIST Boulder back in 2010. So, how can we now implement important feature? We need two microwave modes coupled to same mechanical motion and fishing different decay rates to the environment. I'll probably speed up a little bit because time is not infinite. So, we consider this circuit, which has one mechanical compliant capacitor, three inductors, and one planar capacitor. We engineer these two parts to have same frequency, so to be degenerate. If we write interaction Hamiltonian, it will be like this. We have two modes coupled, and one mode is coupled to mechanical motion, this operator is B. If we then go to the normal modes of this circuit, because they degenerate, we'll get this Hamiltonian. So the modes will split up and down, and one mode will be wide, and one will be narrow, and both will be coupled to mechanical motion. And this wide and narrow is easy to trace. So one mode will have current circulating around this loop, so it will be strongly coupled to the waveguide. And the other one will have this figure eight current, so it flows up here, and then left and right. And so these two currents will cancel each other. And that's why your mode will be dark. So if we just derive it, we write Hamiltonian, we couple to the modes in the waveguide. One mode, second mode has coupling rates. And then after we again transform to normal modes, we'll see that coupling amplitudes will add or will be subtracted for different normal modes. So one will be bright, the other one can be dark. If you ideally match these two halves, then you should not see the dark mode. So this is the schematic, this is the actual circuit. It's planar capacitor, this mechanically compliant drum I showed at the very beginning. So we implemented it, we put it to this copper box, and this copper box to a dilution refrigerator down here. This is all the circuitry we need to measure in reflection or in transmission. But this one was measured basically in reflection. And then we can detect linear response using vector network analyzer or just emitted spectrum using electron spectrum analyzer. And we can apply control pumps and probes. And then, of course, we heavily filter to remove the noise because we want to cool our mechanics close to the ground state, so noise can heat up the mechanics again. So after we cool the structure, we can see two resonances. One is broad, one is very narrow, so it's in bright and dark mode. And here are the parameters. We have two frequencies, 4.3 and 5.4 gigahertz, two kappa, 100 kilohertz, and 4.4 megahertz. So the ratio is very large. It's 40, as we wanted. And in principle, with these parameters, we should be able to cool our mechanics to somewhat half a megahertz, or damped to half a megahertz width, which is 5 times kappa of the narrow mode. So we should be able to realize our experiment. And then we apply pump to the cooling mode. We see that with damped mechanics, it increases linearly, and we can reach this half megahertz. And like this, we create close to Markovian dissipative base for electromagnetic mode. So now we just try to test if really we are in this reverse dissipation regime, if we can see the effects we predicted. So we put cooling pump and fix it forever. And then we sweep another pump around low motional sideband, simultaneously recording the linear response. And from linear response, we extract frequency. And we do see that around red sideband, we see this change in the frequency of the electromagnetic mode. So we pump 5 megahertz away, and we see that frequency changes. On the blue sideband, we see similar curve. In good agreement with the theory, these blue lines are fits to this equation. And if we look for the decay rates, or the widths of the cavities, we do see that on the red side band, we damp, it becomes wider. On the blue side band, it becomes narrower. So we just try to trace the position of this point when we change the pump power. So here we fix the pump at the red side band, and we just increase power. What we see is that our resonance becomes shallower and shallower, which means that we were undercoupled, and we get positive modification by optomechanics, and we just become more undercoupled. If we go to the blue side band, then we see that we become deeper instead. So we become more and more, so we get closer to critically coupled. Then it becomes shallow again, so we go to overcoupled regime when external decay rate dominates over intrinsic decay rate with optomechanical correction, because now correction is negative. Then we go to the regime when our curve is flat, almost. It's slightly funnel, but we basically uncoupled our cavity from the waveguide. So we reach the regime where basically here we have zero. That intrinsic decay rate plus optomechanical correction in total is around zero. And above that point, when we increase pump power, we get net gain, so we start amplifying. We go to the amplification regime. So like this, we demonstrate electromagnetic control over the cavity damping rate. So by applying microwave signal, we control properties of microwave cavity. We can make it undercoupled, critically coupled, overcoupled, or even amplifying. So basically, on the blue side band, we just introduce negative damping rate into cavity mode, which leads to parametric amplification. So we start amplifying, and by this, we decrease the decay rate. So that was this regime. So now we just monitor the spectrum emitted when we increase pump on the blue side band. You see this line becomes narrow, so we start amplifying noise in the cavity. And at some point, we reach threshold, this horizontal line. And after that, we see extremely bright tone going out of the cavity. And we don't move our pump. We just see that it goes slightly to the red sideband, towards the red frequencies by a few kilohertz. And if we look for this magenta line below threshold, we see this amplitude. Above, we see this amplitude, which is 6 orders of magnitude larger. So we go to self-sustained oscillations. So it's kind of a lazy regime. When we create so many photons, that we get lazy. And we can describe this. So below threshold, our line narrows towards zero at the threshold. And after that, we get Mason. So it was first observation of dynamical back action on electromagnetic mode. So it's not only on mechanics you can get back action parametric instability, but also on microwave mode or virtually on any optical mode. So what did we show? In principle, just analog to the optical Raman amplifier / laser. So if you have an optical waveguide, just a cartoon, with, let's say, simulated Raman scattering, simulated Brillouin scattering, and you have some phonons, Raman or Brillouin with omega phonon, you put signal and pump, and if your pump is tuned to signal plus phonon, what happens, that pump generates signals, signal photons, or photons at signal frequency, and phonons. Phonons decay quickly, just work as an idler mode with parametric amplifier. They decay quickly within nanoseconds, and then you amplify your signal, and you lose your pump. And this is a classical process. You can just open nonlinear optics book by Blombergen, and over there it's described. What we did, we created a microwave. It's not propagating photons and phonons cavity-based version of this Raman amplifier. And if we actually look how this amplifier works, we increase pump power, we see we can change gain, and our gain can go high with cooperativity. In principle, it can, with this sample, it was up to 30 dB power gain. And with another sample, it was up to 42 dB. Simultaneously, our bandwidth decreases, and if we consider amplitude gain times bandwidth product, it stays fixed for us. So no miracles, but in principle, for narrow gain, we can reach, for narrow bandwidth, we can reach very high gains. And the noise properties of this amplifier are the following. So here we plot total noise emitted from the amplifier in this chain. So we have our amplifier, we have some cables and other devices. Before, we have cryogenic high electromobility transistor amplifier, and then we measure it outside. So we have total noise, which is noise added by our device, plus noise of the HEMT divided over the gain of our device, and a little bit corrected by this insertion loss. And noise of HEMT amplifier is around 22 quanta, and noise of our device is described by this equation, which takes into account extrinsic decay rate, intrinsic decay rate, and so on. And then we see that basically we add only few phonons, overall taking into account HEMT, but at large gains we add just below 2 photons of noise. And this dashed line is this quantum limit for our device, which is 0.78. So our total system noise is around just twice larger than quantum limit, which we can get in our device with this intrinsic decay rate and extrinsic decay rate. So from this, we can extract effective occupation of the mechanical mode. And it's around 0.665 quanta. So we are close to the ground state. And in principle, this laser or sideband cooled mechanical oscillator constitutes a quantum reservoir. So you can use it to realize quantum devices or demonstrate quantum effects. So let me conclude. So we realize electromechanics in the reverse dissipation regime, where dissipation of mechanical mode dominates over dissipation of electromagnetic mode. We show control over electromagnetic cavity properties using this cold dissipative reservoir. We showed near quantum limited amplification of microwave field, and we showed the Maser action. So more generally, we realized a quantum dissipative mechanical reservoir for microwaves. And this is a prerequisite for new class of dissipative photomechanical interactions. So using this kind of reservoir, you can realize other effects. You can read about this result here. It's now published, also in paper version. And thank you for your attention.